William Morrow and Harper Audio present Lady in the Lake, a novel by Laura Lippman, performed by Susan Bennett. Part 1. I saw you once. I saw you, and you noticed me because you caught me looking at you, seeing you. Back and forth, back and forth. Good-looking women do that. Lock eyes, then look one another up and down. I could tell at a glance you've never doubted you're good-looking, and you still had the habit of checking a room to make sure you were the best-looking. You scanned the crowd of people on the sidewalk, and your eyes caught mine, if only for a moment, then dropped away. You saw me. You tallied up the points. Who won? My hunch is that you gave yourself the crown, because you saw a Negro woman, a poor one at that. In the animal kingdom, the male performs for the woman. Woos her with his beautiful feathers or flowing mane, is always trying to outstrut the other men. Why do humans do it the other way? It doesn't make sense. Men need us more than we need them. You were in the minority that day. You were in our neighborhood, and almost everyone else there would have picked me. Younger, taller, shapelier, me. Maybe even your husband, Milton. Part of the reason I first noticed you was because you were next to him. He now looked exactly like his father, a man I remembered with some affection. I can't say the same about Milton. I guessed from the way people gathered around him on the temple steps, patted his back, clasped his hands in theirs, that it must have been his father who had died. And I could tell from the way that people waited to comfort him that Milton was a big shot. The temple was a block from the park. The park and the lake and the fountain. Isn't that interesting? I was probably taking a roundabout way to Druid Hill that afternoon, a book in my purse. Not that I like the outdoors that much, but there were 8 people, my father and mother, my sister and 2 brothers, my 2 boys, and me, living in our apartment, and there was never a moment's peace, to use my father's phrase. I would slip a book into my purse, Jean Plady or Victoria Holt, and say, I'm going to the library, and Mama didn't have the heart to say no. She never faulted me for picking 2 good-for-nothing men and turning up back home like a bad penny. I was her first, and I was her favorite. But not so favored that I could get away with a 3rd mistake. Mama was on me to go back to school, become a nurse. A nurse. I couldn't imagine taking a job where you had to touch people you didn't want to touch. When things got too much at home, when there were too many bodies and voices, I'd go to the park and walk the paths, drink up the silence, drop to a bench, and lose myself in ye olden days of England. Later, people said I was a terrible person, moving out on my own, leaving my babies behind with their grandparents, but I was thinking of them. I needed a man, and not just any old man. My boys' fathers had proved that much to me. I had to find the kind of man who would provide for us, all of us. To do that, I needed to be on my own for a little while, even if it meant living with my friend Letitia, who basically ran a one-woman school on how to get men to pay for everything. My mama believed that when you put the cheese out for the mouse, you have to make it look at least a little appetizing. Cut the mold off, or place it in the trap so the mold is on the side that doesn't show. I had to look good, and I had to look as if I didn't have a care in the world. And I couldn't manage that in my family's crowded apartment, on Auchentrolley Terrace. Okay. So maybe I could imagine taking a job where you had to touch people you didn't want to touch. But what woman doesn't do that? You did it yourself, I'm guessing, when you married Milton Schwartz. Because no one could fall in fairy tale love with the Milton Schwartz I once knew. It was. I can remember, if I figure out how old my babies were. 1964, late fall, the faintest chill in the air. You had a plain black pillbox hat, no veil. I bet people told you that you looked like Jackie Kennedy. I bet you liked it, even as you denied it with a "who me" laugh. The wind ruffled your hair, but only a little. You had that due shellacked. You wore a black coat with fur at the throat and cuffs. Believe me, I remember that coat. And boy, Milton looked so much like his father. And it was only then that I realized that old Mr. Schwartz had been kinda young and kinda handsome when I was a kid. When I was a little girl, buying candy in his store, I thought he was old. He wasn't even 40. Now I was 26. And Milton had to be almost 40, and there you were, next to him. And I could not get over what a fine woman he had gotten for himself. Maybe he was nicer now, I thought. People change. They do. They do. I did. It's just that no one will ever know. What did you see? I can't remember what I was wearing, but I can guess. A coat, too thin even for that mild day. Probably came from a church box, so it was pilled and limp, saggy at the hem. Scuffed shoes, run-down heels. Your shoes were black and shiny. My legs were bare. You had the kind of stockings that almost shimmered. Looking at you, I saw the trick to it. To get a man with money, I would need to look as if I didn't need money. I was going to have to find a job in a place where the tips came in folding money, not change thrown on the table. Problem was, those kinds of places didn't hire Negroes, not as waitresses. The one time I got a restaurant gig, I was a dishwasher, stuck in the back, cut off from the tips. The best restaurants didn't hire women to wait tables even if they were white. I was gonna have to be creative, find a job somewhere that I could meet the kind of men who bought a girl things, which would make me more desirable to the men who played for bigger stakes, allow me to trade up and up and up. I knew what that meant. What I would have to exchange for those things. I wasn't a girl anymore. I had two sons to prove it. So when you saw me, and you did, I'm sure of it, our eyes caught, held one another's. You saw my ratty clothes, but you also saw my green eyes, my straight nose, the face that gave me my nickname. Although later I would meet a man who said I reminded him of a duchess, not an empress. That I should be called Helen. He said it was because I was beautiful enough to start a war. And didn't I just? I don't know what else you would call it. Maybe not a big war, but a war all the same, in which men turned on one another, allies became enemies, all because of me. In a flash, you showed me where I wanted to go. And how to get there. I had one more chance, one more man. I did not imagine that day that our paths would ever cross again, small as Baltimore can be. You were just the woman who married the nasty teenager who used to torment me, and now the nasty boy was a nice-looking man who was burying his father. I need a husband like that, I thought. Not a white man, of course, but a man who could buy me a coat with fur at the neck and the cuffs. A man who would command everyone's respect. A woman is only as good as the man at her side. My father would have slapped me if he heard such words come out of my mouth. Make me find and memorize all the Bible verses about vanity and pride. But it wasn't vanity on my part. I needed a man to help care for my boys. A well-to-do man needs a beautiful woman. That's what I figured out that day. You were there to comfort Milton, to help him bury his father. But you were also an advertisement for his work and success. I can't believe you left him a year later. But death has a way of changing people. God knows my death has changed me. Alive, I was Cleo Sherwood. Dead, I became the lady in the lake. A nasty, broken thing, dragged from the fountain after steeping there for months. Through the cold winter, then that fitful, bratty spring, almost into summer proper. Face gone, much of my flesh gone. And no one cared until you came along. Gave me that stupid nickname. Began rattling doorknobs and pestering people, going places you weren't supposed to go. No one outside my family was supposed to care. I was a careless girl who went out on a date with the wrong person and was never seen again. You came in at the end of my story and turned it into your beginning. Why'd you have to go and do that, Madeline Schwartz? Why couldn't you stay in your beautiful house and your good enough marriage and let me be at the bottom of the fountain? I was safe there. Everybody was safer when I was there. October, 1965. What do you mean you've invited Wallace Wright to dinner? Maddie Schwartz longed to take the question back the second it was out of her mouth. Maddie Schwartz did not act like women in television variety shows and songs. She neither nagged nor schemed. She did not need to hear a Jack Jones song to remind her to fix her hair and makeup before her husband came through the door at day's end. Maddie Schwartz prided herself on being unflappable. Invite the boss home at the last minute? Surface with two never-before-mentioned cousins from Toledo? Show up with an old high school friend? Maddie was always ready for the challenge. She ran her household much as her mother had run hers, with a sly wit and effortless seeming, organization. Unlike her mother, she accomplished these domestic miracles by spending freely. Milton's shirts went to the best laundry in North Baltimore. Although it was miles from her usual routes, she dropped off, he picked up. A cleaning girl came twice a week. Maddie's famous yeast rolls were out of a can, her freezer full of staples. She used caterers for the Schwartz's most ambitious parties, the New Year's Day open house for Milton's colleagues from the law firm, and the spontaneous spring party that was such a success that they felt obliged to keep having it. People really loved that party, spoke about it throughout the year with sincere anticipation. Yes, Maddie Schwartz was good at entertaining, and therefore happy to do it. She took particular pride in her ability to throw together a dinner party with almost no warning. Even when she wasn't enthusiastic about a certain guest, she never kvetched. So, Milton was within his rights to be surprised by her peevish tone on this late October afternoon.
"I thought you'd be excited," Milton said. "He is a little, well, famous."
Maddie regrouped quickly. "Don't mind me, I'm just worried that he's used to dining in a grander style than I can manage on short notice. But maybe he would be charmed by meatloaf and scalloped potatoes. I guess life is all lobster Thermidor and steak Diane when you're Wallace Wright."
"He says he knew you a little, back in school?" Oh, we were years apart, Maddie said. Knowing her generous husband would infer that Wallace Wright was the older one. He was, in fact, 2 years younger, a grade behind her at the park school, and many rungs down the high school social ladder. He had been Wally Weiss then. Today, one could barely turn on WOLD TV without being subjected to Wallace Wright. He hosted the noon news.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.